I'd like to welcome everybody out today for the funeral for Sheri Betty Mellor. Gotta excuse me, in the on here it says that Bishop Hammond will be conducting. He actually came down and was sick and didn't want to come spread it to everybody. So my name is Brother Joe Mellor and I'll be conducting today. We want to celebrate the life of Sheri Betty Mellor, our kind and beloved mother, daughter, sister, aunt, cousin, friend, and neighbor. Sheri was born June 10th, 1980 in Gunnison, Utah. She died December 18th, 2021 in Manti, Utah. Her parents are Gerald Melvin and Margene Jensen Mellor. Son, Caden Mellor. Siblings are Matt Mellor, Jenny and Brett Cox, Chris and Elisa Mellor. Nieces and nephews are Lena Mellor, Raquel Cox, Max Cox, Bailey Cox, Addison Mellor, and Jameson Mellor. Is preceded in death by grandparents Melvin and Betty Mellor, Robert S. and Marjorie C. Jensen. The family prayer has already taken place by Brett Cox, brother-in-law. We'll begin with an invocation by Raquel Cox, niece, after which we'll have a congregational hymn on page 129, Where Can I Turn for Peace? After which we'll have a tribute by Jenny Cox, sister, a tribute by Chris Mellor, brother, a tribute by Matt Mellor, brother. We'll then have a vocal solo by Bailey Cox, niece. After that, we'll have a tribute by Caden Mellor, son, a tribute by Margene Mellor, mom, tribute by Gerald Mellor, her father, and we'll go to there.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are thankful for those who could come and honor the life of Sheri. Please bless thy spirit to be with us today. Bless all those participating in the service today to be able to share what they have prepared. And please watch over and comfort our family and loved ones during this time. We love thee and ask of these blessings in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming to honor Sheri and support our family. I'll do my best to get through this and have it be good. I'm Jenny Cox. I'm Sheri's sister. I'm 4 years older than her. So by the time she was starting eighth grade, I was moving out of our house. So a lot of my memories aren't from like her teenage high school years, but they're from when she was younger. Sheri had a really funny personality. A lot of her friends here will know that. She loved to dress herself. And when she was, I don't know, three or four, she would wear all the time a green football jersey with cowboy boots and a cowboy hat and a long necklace and no pants. And she was super stubborn and persistent. And so I don't think there's anything my mom could have done to get her to change or wear something different. We have pictures of that though, and that's how I remember her. I kind of wish we would have thrown one of those in the program. She had a favorite orange Beanie Baby and she carried it everywhere. And one night she lost it and she refused to go to sleep until my dad found it. Unfortunately, she had been out playing in the Pickett's horse corrals and that's where it was. We shared a room for several years, and as all loving sisters, we had an imaginary line or sometimes a real line down the middle that we were not allowed to cross, and she didn't follow rules. And so she would cross it, and she'd get in my stuff all the time, and I loved my Barbies. They were my most favorite thing. Michelle can tell you that. But she loved to cut off all their hair, and so that's why we had to have the line there. Sheri was adventurous. Not much scared her. We were kind of opposite in that way. I was not as adventurous as her, but she loved to go wave running and four-wheeling. She wasn't afraid of heights, whether it was a helicopter ride with Caden or sitting on the edge of a cliff. She would also go hunting and shooting with my dad's and brothers. So she had a lot of outdoor-type hobbies. Sheri loved her nieces and nephews. When my kids were little, we spent a lot more time together, and she was a really fun aunt. I've never been somebody that loved animals, but she always made certain that Brickell had plenty of kittens to bring home to Manti. I won't tell you how many we went through because we weren't the best at keeping them. Bailey's been entertaining us, my youngest, since she could stand. She's been dancing and singing for us, and Sheri was always a really big fan. We would sit in my mom's living room for hours, and she would ask Bailey to show her all of her new tricks, which could be crazy or really cool, but she would be entertained and she loved it. She always made time for Caden and Max to get together and play. She loved Elena, Jameson, and Addie. I am not sure if much made her happier than being with them these last several years. Sheri had Caden a year before I had my oldest, Brickell. So she was a really young mom, but she dove in with all that she had, and she did everything she could for Caden. She provided him a lot of opportunity. They had a lot of fun together. She was a really good mom. She was the best that she could be. She had stepkids through the years, and they adored her, and she provided them a lot of opportunities and tried to fill a void that they had in their life. Sheri loved her grandmas. She is our only sibling that wasn't given a middle name when she was born. And going back to her stubbornness, that wasn't fair, and she really wanted a middle name. So when she was 14, she legally changed her name to Sheri Betty Mellor in honor of our grandma Betty. She truly loved both of her grandmas. In preparation for today, I ran across a talk by Dallin H. Oaks, and it's called Powerful Ideas. And it was super fitting, and it was something that could comfort me, so I wanted to share just three of the ideas in there. These last several years, I haven't had the relationship with Sheri that I would have liked to have had, and President Oaks teaches an idea that's powerful to lift us from discouragement is the work of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints to bring to pass the eternal life of man is an eternal work. Not all problems are overcome. Not all needed relationships are fixed in mortality. The work of salvation goes on beyond the veil of death, and we should not be too apprehensive about incompleteness within the limits of mortality. I'm thankful to know that our sisterhood and our love for each other will continue to grow, and it will be complete someday. Sheri's life, from our viewpoint, was cut short, way too short. The second powerful idea I want to share is that mortal life has a purpose, and mortal death is not the end, but a transition phase. The idea of eternal progress is one of the most powerful ideas in our theology. It gives us hope when we falter and challenge when we soar. Sheri will continue to progress, and she's going to have opportunities that she didn't have here, and that can be a great comfort. The last powerful idea can be put to immediate use by anyone mourning the loss of a loved one, and that is that we can pray to our Heavenly Father. He'll hear our prayers, and he'll help us in the way that's best for us, and that might be different for everyone. Most of us have experienced the terrible empty feeling that comes from being separated from those who love us and that we love. If we remember that we can pray and be heard and helped, we can always withstand that feeling of emptiness. Heavenly Father can help us in his own way and his own time. I love Sheri, and I love my family. And I'm just grateful for the knowledge and the testimony I have of eternal families, and that we will see her again someday. And I say this in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ, amen.
Hello, I'm Chris. I'm Sheri's younger brother. I would like to share a quote that Sheri had hanging on her wall at home. Sheri has faced more pain and struggles than most people. Under her beautiful smile, there are scars that no one knows about. Life has not always been easy for her, but she does not regret her past. It was part of the process to reach a happy life. Her scars are part of her. One of my favorite memories of Sheri took place when I was around 10 years old. Sheri took a cousin and I to Palisade Lodge to go down the big water slide. There were three older teenage boys at the slide that were picking on me and my cousin. Sheri saw this and jumped into action. She fought all three teenagers at the same time and kicked their butts. But the teenagers left us alone after that. Other memories include the time she dressed me up as a girl and made me knock on the Pickett's door. Or the time she put food coloring in the pickle juice and told me it was Kool-Aid. I have hated pickles since. Sheri was very good with my children. They both love her so much, and she was a good sister to me. We all love her, and we will all miss her dearly.
I'm Matt, Sheri's older brother, and after hearing Chris's story, I'm glad I was the older brother. She didn't do that to me. No, there's a lot of really interesting things that we could say at these types of moments. Some of the things that I'll say are probably tainted by my profession a little bit. I work in the mental health field, and I believe that there's a lot of things that are important. One of them is perspective. We all look at things differently. We view them differently, and we experience them differently. And, you know, we could have a cup of water here that, say, could hold a cup and a half worth of water, right? We could have 3/4 of a cup of water in it. And you guys have all heard about the cup half empty or half full. You know, supposedly you're an optimist if you say it's half full. Or a pessimist if you say it's half empty. Or maybe you're just making it up and saying it's half full because you want people to think you're the optimist. I could imagine another response, and that response would be, no, the cup's got 3/4 a cup of water in it. Because that's just what it is. The situation with Sheri is sad. And it is what it is. Sheri was sometimes a difficult sister, but we loved her. And sometimes I was probably a difficult brother, and I think she loved me. You know, there's a story that comes up to my mind quite often, and I got to relive this for like the last 30 years of my life or so. One time when I was probably around 10 or 11, somewhere around that age, I was working on homework. And Sheri loved to get our attention, sometimes in ways that we didn't appreciate. She came up and stole my pencil and ran off with it. She ran into her room while I was chasing her. Maybe I had a few thoughts of murder in my mind, I don't know. At that age, those types of thoughts, we don't really understand what we're thinking. She jumped on her bed and turned around and jumped on her bed so that her back was to the wall and stabbed herself with the pencil. At least that's my perspective. Her perspective is entirely different. And for the last 30 years or so, I've heard about how I stabbed her in the hand with the pencil. I guarantee you that my perspective is more correct. Maybe not. But perspectives are important. Those are where our beliefs are formed. All of our thoughts are based on our beliefs, and our actions are based on our thoughts. If we have thoughts that are not, or if we have beliefs that are not true, they impact our thoughts and our actions. And I've warned you that my profession may taint my talk a little bit. There are four types of behavior. The thoughts and actions are two of those. They're the two that we can control. The feelings and the physiology are two parts of behavior we cannot control. And our beliefs and thoughts impact our feelings, just like our feelings impact our thoughts and our beliefs. There were things that I am sure my sister believed about herself that were not true. Because of those beliefs, she had a lot of hard experiences in life. This really needs to bend right here so it's not in my face. But with those experiences that she had, they impacted her and they helped form more beliefs. And unfortunately, I don't think her beliefs were always that she was loved. I hope that as she is here today, she can realize that was a false belief, and that she can feel differently than she may have. Because there is a lot of power in identifying those true beliefs and getting rid of the false ones. Hey, you do have tissues up here. That's good. Now, I have not followed my talk that I wrote out at all, other than a few things. But I knew that would happen. That always does when I talk. The thought of trying to read the lines on my phone and follow along just doesn't work. But in life, there's a few things that we believe. Some of them are right, some of them are not. There's a few things that we come to know. One of the things that I know is that God loves us. And based on the knowledge that God loves us that I have, I find it very easy to believe that Sheri was met with love. This life is a test. But it's not about checking off a bunch of stupid little boxes of I did this and I did that just perfectly. It's about how hard we try. Sheri never gave up. And I know that It may not have looked like she hadn't. Or it may have looked like she had given up at times to some, but I don't believe that for a second. And I know enough about behavior to be able to say that. She did not give up. And as far as I'm concerned, that means she passed that test. I know that God loves us all, and that what we do doesn't change that love. And I know that as much as I know I will always love my sister. And I can't wait to see her again, although I hope it's not too soon. I kind of enjoy life a little bit. But I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear. Appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, my God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace.
Caden was having a very, very difficult time, and he didn't feel like he could be here because of his emotions, and he's really hurting. So I'm going to give the remarks that Caden had prepared. Caden said that he loved his mother with all of his heart. She was his world. Sheri had a statement on her wall down in her room that Caden wanted to have read. It's called Hope. God gave you the gift of hope. You laugh, even if sometimes you are sad. You're caring and giving, even if sometimes you're exhausted. Your motto is, storms do not last forever. You may never give up, and you know that no matter what, you can always make it through. That was Caden's tribute to his mother.
He has to stay here to hold me up. Today's the day we honor our Sheri. And I pray that I can express my love adequately to honor our daughter, because she truly deserves my love and my respect. From a very young age, it became apparent that Sheri was Daddy's girl. Gerald will talk more about that, but she was definitely her Daddy's girl, and she loved him very much. But like all kids, they know exactly which parent to get the most out of. You know what I mean? And Sheri knew that I had a place in her life too. When she was lost, I was hurting for her. When she faced difficulties in life, I shared them too. I loved Sheri with all my heart, and I know she loved me too. To me, Sheri is my little wildflower, not maybe in the sense that you think. Wildflowers grow freely, resiliently, and beautifully. When you step on a wildflower, it doesn't die. It picks itself up and keeps on growing. Wildflowers can thrive and grow almost anywhere. Sheri pulled herself up many times and kept going time after time in many situations. She faced many trials in her short life. Some of those trials were from the choices she made. Many trials were from physical health issues that she suffered with and faced. And some trials were inflicted on her by others. She had many difficult days, but she kept on trying through it all. President Gordon B. Hinckley once wrote in part, "Don't worry. If you do your best, it will all work out." I believe with all my heart, Sheri did her best. And I know it will work out for her. After Sheri passed away, Gerald and I were in her room. And Sheri was a very private person. So I had not seen the inside of her room for a very, very long time. But there on her walls were pages and pages of statements, things that she wrote, things that meant a lot to her, and pictures of people that she loved. I'd like to read one. Gerald read you one, and here's another one. This year, I have come to realize that there is no reason for me to doubt how far I can go. Every time I try to sell myself short, I think back to everything I faced and overcome on my journey. And she signed her name at the bottom, Sheri. Sheri loved her son, as has been mentioned. But she loved him so much, she could never see him suffer. So when it was time to take the bottle away, had to do it. Sheri couldn't be that mean. When it was time to get rid of the binky, Sheri couldn't do that either. She just could not have that boy sad. She did everything she could to make him happy. She took him to places and did things with him. That kid had everything under the sun. She was a mother and a father to Caden, and she just loved him. I don't know very many, maybe it's because she had him when she was so young, but she even took him to many rock concerts. Grandma would never have been doing that. But they went together and they had so much fun together and they had good times and enjoyed them. She went on the four-wheeler rides, and one terrible time, when it was time to be at the lake, we went there often, and Sheri wasn't there yet, so I took Caden for a ride on the wave runner, and I tipped the sled over and knocked him in the water, and all I could think of is, Sherry's gonna kill me. I swam the fastest I've ever swam in my life and grabbed that kid and got back to shore. And Sheri was not happy with me when she came. Sheri had a special worry when Caden was little. She, at that time, was not endowed in the temple and not married. And Caden wasn't sealed to anyone. And that brought such anguish to her. She wanted him sealed to her. And I'm so thankful that that day did come and that Caden was able to be sealed to her, because that meant a lot to her. Sheri chose her own path in this life. And she made mistakes like all of us do. But there was a lot of goodness in that girl. She often helped people in need. When my mother came to live with us, Gerald and I were concerned because we both needed to be working full time. And sometimes my job was even longer than full time. And we weren't sure what to do with Mom. She couldn't be alone all the time. She just couldn't. Sheri stepped up to help. She was working full-time too, but she came to my house every morning at 8 o'clock and helped my mother with her pancakes, because that's all she would eat, were pancakes. But she helped her eat the pancakes, and she did a jigsaw puzzle with her every single day, and they watched Matlock together, because my mother worked with him a long time. So they did that. And another thing that was so important to my mother was family history. My mother's family history is 114 pages plus. And I don't mean this size. This size. Sheri took my mother's history along with my dad's history, my Uncle Roger's history, my Grandma Crane and Grandpa Crane's histories, and made them on the smaller pages and put them in protective covers and made books for my mother. That must have taken hours and hours and hours. But she did it happily. And at 2:30, when Gerald was able to come home, then Sheri would go home and get ready for work and work a full shift. She sacrificed a lot help me. I know that Sheri was welcomed by her Grandma Betty and her Grandma Jensen. They loved her. And I know that Sheri is in the loving arms of our Savior. I wrote down just a couple of quick, silly memories that I'd like to share. Sheri was thoughtful and mischievous and full of fun. She never really got over that thing about the, well, Jenny remembers the green football shirt. I remember the Bat Band shirt, which I finally had to hide, and the necklace, and actually, I think there were a pair of panties on her head, like those Superman panties. I don't know. That was her favorite outfit, with the boots. And she never quite got over that. She loved to just wear a big T-shirt and a pair of boxer shorts. That was her at-home outfit. One day she got up for school, and then she fixed her hair, and she ate breakfast, and she picked up her books and was ready to go out the door. And she said, well, I'll see you later, Mom. And I said, did you want to wear pants today? She had forgotten to get dressed. Another experience I remember with Sheri that is just the cutest thing ever. In elementary school one day, she said, so how does it work when you go to the temple? Do they just line the boys up on one side and the girls on one side, and then you just go grab one to get married? And then she proceeded to tell me who she was going to grab. That was a sweet, sweet memory. Then there was those teenage years. Holy cow. I worked a block away from home, and it was a two-story building, and there was a big window up in the break room, and you could see my house and the backyard. And one day, when I wasn't at work even, my coworkers told me they could see this big, huge cloud of dust just getting bigger and bigger and bigger in my backyard. They almost thought it was a fire. No. The Sheri without a driver's license was driving in the backyard in circles around and around and around till it was so dusty that she couldn't see. Then, the driving years after she got a license, we had a car that was a Thunderbird, and I believe we bought it from Neil or something. Anyway, it had kind of a turbo engine or some sort of thing. Sheri drove it up the G Hill in Gunnison, somewhere where that car never should have been. And after that, she named the car the Thunder Chicken. And that was how she always was, the Thunder Chicken. Those are just some sweet little memories that I hold dear to my heart. Sheri had her challenges, and they were difficult. I spent many hours with her driving to the doctor, taking care of her, helping her with feeding tubes, and all kinds of things. She didn't complain most of the time. There were times that it got a little hard, but I appreciate that time I was able to spend with Sheri. I want to thank everyone that has shown so much love to our family. Thank you for the phone calls, the texts, the visits to our home, the food, and all the other compassion and love that has been given to us. We thank you from the bottom of our hearts, and we are forever grateful. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Before I forget, I would like to thank everyone who has come here. And I'd like to especially thank everyone who has been a part of Sheri's life, who's shown her love, kindness, compassion, friendship. My talk is going to be kind of a little mixed talk, kind of like a celebration of Sheri's life. As a young child, Sheri was always smiling, laughing, happy and full of fun, just like a little spark. When she was really young, when I'd come home from working late at night, and sometimes it was way late, sometimes about the middle of the night, Sheri would come and find me, and we had a little routine. We'd go peel an orange and then split the little pieces off and go sit down in the family room in a corner on the floor and eat it. But also we'd get some Sprite. I enjoyed Sprite. It was soothing to my throat. We'd both drink a glass of Sprite. Sheri would drink a little bit and then she'd burp. And then she'd just giggle and giggle. She thought that was really funny. And so she named Sprite Burpsy Pop. She had a little jingle that she said, "Burpsy Pop, I love you." And then she'd burp. But anyway, it was a lot of fun. She was always a very interesting young little gal. Marjane and I, when Sheri was real little, they had that song, "Sheri Baby." And we would sing that to her. And Sheri thought that was her song, made up for her. And one day she heard it on the radio. And she came running in and said, "The radio's singing to me. They know my song." You know, as a young girl, Sheri enjoyed playing with the neighbor kids and being involved in their activities and the things that were going on. Jenny talked about the Beaner Baby doll in the horse corral and tree hut area. I had to go out looking at night with my flashlight through the horse corral and climb up the tree to find her Beaner Baby doll before she'd go to sleep that night, because she always had to hug her doll before she'd go to sleep. She enjoyed her little dancing groups that she was involved in as a young girl. Sheri enjoyed being outdoors and doing things with me. As Marjane said, she was kind of daddy's girl. As a young child, and even older, Sheri liked snow sports. Snowball fights, sleigh riding, or tubing, whether it was going down a hill or being pulled behind my pickup up the canyon roads. She loved the outdoors. When she got a little older, she wanted to go trapping bobcats with me. I was a little nervous, but she was not afraid of anything and loved to go out and be outside, so I took her with me. And we went up in the bottom of Timber Canyon, which is out north of town, just south of Flat Canyon. And it was kind of real steep, high hills and kind of a lot of shell rock going up and a lot of ledges, and we like to trap along the ledges. And I took a couple little traps along with my big ones with, and we got clear to the very highest ledge, and Sheri said, "These two places, I want these two traps." So we set them. And then we went on down and set other traps as we went down. And the next trip up the canyon, the only two bobcats we caught were in the two traps that Sheri wanted set in those places. So Sheri still has one hanging. We had one tanned and put on her wall, you know, as a rug, and she still has it in her room. Then on our way back down the canyon, sometimes the ground was frozen because it was winter time, and it was kind of hard to walk. And a lot of times you'd slip and fall. So when we got closer to the bottom, we decided it was a lot safer to just sit down on our britches and kind of slide down carefully. Well, by the time we got to the bottom of the hill, we both had holes in our pants. So she just laughed and laughed about that all the way home. She thought that was funny. Gotta keep up with my notes here.
He's got 20 pages.
Little papers. As Sheri got into high school, She enjoyed sport activities. Sheri was on the tennis and the softball teams, and she really enjoyed it. Sheri enjoyed water sports. There was times I'd be at work and she would call and ask if she could use my pickup to go wave running. She'd hook the wave runner trailer to the pickup and get some of her friends and go up to Gunnison Reservoir, enjoy the afternoon on the wave runners, and then she'd back the truck back in the water, load the wave runners back up, strap them down, and come home without any problem. She just wasn't afraid to try anything, and she had a lot of good common sense. And then a lot of times I'd get off work just before sundown, and I'd come home, and I enjoyed wave running, and I'd ask Sheri if she'd like to go out to the Yuba, and she was always willing to go. And so we'd unload on our property in the Narrows at the Yuba, and we would get on the sleds, and we'd go clear down to the dam, down by the Scipio Way, and then turn around and come back up. And the sleds, the one would do 50, and the other would do 60, so we'd go as fast as we could down, and we could get clear down to the dam, turn around, come back, and have the wave runners loaded back up just before dark to come home. We really cruised, and she enjoyed that. It was just out enjoying smooth water, nice water, and just having a good time being out. Sheri had a couple teachers in school that I really have to appreciate and respect. Sheri loved to go hunting with me, and she loved shooting guns. She had her own AR-15 and her own 22 Ruger 10-22 and her own 22 pistol. But she wanted to try hunting deer. She had a class from Ron Daly. Ron invited her to come out to Flat Canyon to hunt on their property. She got out there the one time, and she found a nice 3-point buck, and I think it was Chris that was with. Sheri got out and went to shoot the buck, and she shot. Oops. And she looked over, where's the deer go? Where'd it go? Where'd it run? Chris said, you hit it. It's laying down. And the next time we went out, the next year, Ron was really good. If he didn't see us out there, he'd call, hey, ring Sheri and come on out. We got out there, and this was just after Caden was, about a year and a half, 2 years old. And we went out, and there was a lot of deer in the fields. And Caden seen the deer, and it excited him. And we had the windows down so we could see a little better. And he'd just squeal, and the deer would take off running. So we had to roll the windows up in order to get close to the deer. And then Sheri got out, and she had her AR-15. And this one, poor deer, she emptied it. Her clip on it. It had holes all over in it, but she got it. She got it, but it had holes everywhere from the foot on up to the head. But she quite enjoyed that type of stuff. It was fun to get out and to go, and it was fun for her to have Caden with her. Even though he was young, Sheri was a very smart, intellectually intelligent young lady. She had a very excellent mind and a very excellent memory. And she was also very physically active. In school, Sheri also assisted Pat Jensen with the special ed students. Sheri always had a very kind heart and a desire to help others to accomplish things which they could not do for themselves. She had a very special ability to be a caregiver and of giving of herself, showing kindness, caring, and love. She had a very special connection with people and the ability to feel with her heart. She was able to feel the needs of other people. She had the ability to perceive their needs and to be able to assist them in achieving their goals. One little example was when she was helping these special ed kids, there was one boy there that really physically struggled with his coordination and stuff. And their goal was to build a birdhouse and to get a pole and to put the birdhouse in their yard behind their home for the birds to come and to feed out of and stuff so they could see it. Well, this one little kid really struggled. So Sheri helped him cut out all the material, helped him assemble the house and paint it. And then she come and asked me if I could make a pole for them that was strong enough to hold up his birdhouse, because it was a pretty good birdhouse size that she'd made for him. And then Sheri went with that kid to his house and installed that birdhouse in their backyard to be sure that it got put up, because she was afraid that it wouldn't get put up. But she made sure that that was put up. When Caden come into a life, what a blessing and a joy. Sheri loved Caden so much and took very good care of him. Sheri provided him with everything that she could. She spent a lot of times doing things with Caden. Sheri had both the role of a father and a mother. Sheri really enjoyed being involved in Cub Scouts. When she was there, she would go way beyond what was expected of her to make sure that it was a special experience for the kids. Sheri enjoyed a lot of things with Caden: snow sports, sleigh riding, tubing, snowman building, snowball fighting, making snow angels. She enjoyed water sports. She really enjoyed going out on the wave runners. She enjoyed hiking, camping, hunting. She always tried her best to do her best for her and for her son. She had some very life-changing experiences at a young age. She had had to have a gastric bypass because of some physical difficulties. Years later, she had some digestive issues. And she went to a surgeon and he said, "We'll need to go in and we'll need to check in the colon." And he says, "If there's a little bad spot, we'll remove a small 6 or 8 inch section and you'll be fine." Well, we went to the hospital with her. Sheri went into surgery. A very unscrupulous surgeon went in, done a surgery, came out to us and said, "The colon was healthy, but while I was there, I removed it." After that, Sheri's life and health and ability to have good health was changed forever. She had complications. She had her body without a colon, you can't build iron. You have to have iron to live. So she'd have to have iron infusions, which was very, very painful for her. And the pain would last anywhere from 2 to 4 weeks before she'd feel good again. And with the iron, it made her teeth go bad. And so she lost her teeth. Then she could not build the blood corpuscles. And so she had to have numerous blood transfusions to keep her blood level up. No one knows the pain suffering and torment and humiliation that she had to bear. Some people would make very judgmental remarks who had no idea what she was experiencing, and that really hurt her deeply. She experienced many different things in relationships that caused her to lose a lot of faith and trust in people. She had one individual that he went to with a very serious issue. And the guy told her, oh, it's all in your head, you're just imagining it. It was not in Sheri's head, and no, she was not imagining it. But that hurt her so deeply that she kind of went away from the church. Sheri believed the church was true, but she had been hurt so badly by people that she trusted. Sheri still cared very deeply about other people. And Sheri, even though she went through many challenges and many struggles and many heartaches, she did her very best to help those who she knew needed help that she could do. Sheri kind of put up a wall and kind of closed people off a little bit from getting into her life. She became a very private person. Those that Sheri let into her life, she had a lot of trust and a lot of love and respect for. And those of you, I really appreciate and love and respect you for what you have been and the love and the help and the care that you gave Sheri. Sheri had a note on her wall. She thanked the world for knocking her down. And when she'd get back up, for knocking her down again. Because she said, without that, she would have never known how strong she had to be and was to be able to stand up again. Sheri loved life. She loved people. She cared about people. Sheri wanted to be happy and to be loved. And she wanted other people to feel like they were loved, like someone cared about them. She wanted people to be happy. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, I'm grateful that I get to make a few remarks. For those of you that don't know me, I grew up right next door to Sheri. And I was just a year older. And so I knew her very well. I was her cousin and also part of a kind of a different family. There were a ton of us kids growing up on that block. You had the Mellors and us Mellors, the Picketts, the Bartholomews, the Lymans and Kings, and as I look around, I see a lot of those family members here today. And we had a lot of fun and got in a lot of trouble, and there's one story about Sheri that I have to tell because she never, ever let me live it down. You know, not too long ago, within the last 20 years, whenever I would run into Sheri anywhere, it could be the grocery store, it could be at work, I work at the hospital, anywhere around town, we'd bump into each other and we'd start talking, and it didn't matter who walked by, if we knew them or if they were almost strangers, she would grab them and be like, hey, do you know this guy right here broke my arm when we were little? And I have never lived that down, ever. I knew I was little, but I had to ask Margene how old we were. So Sheri was in first grade, so I would have been in second grade. And of course, there was a big crew of us out there roughhousing, and I thought I was awesome because I was in wrestling, you know, and I was going to take her down. And obviously, it didn't work out very well because it broke her arm. And so, yeah. I'm still the guy that broke the little girl's arm. But, you know, because then through my work, I work at the hospital, and I get to see a lot of death at the hospital. A lot of our patients that we get to know really well and they come in, and then eventually they pass on. And there's a lot of tragic things that come in, and it's actually been a good thing. It's increased my testimony that there is life after death, that this earth is just a short little temporary place where we prepare to meet God. And I know that Sheri has moved on, that she's met God, that she's with those her ancestors that went on before her, and that she is in a better place. And I just want to close with that. Say that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We will now have a congregational hymn, page 152. God be with you till we meet again. After that, the benediction will be given by Max Cox, the nephew. And then we will move to the cemetery where the dedication of the grave will take place.
Our dear, kind, gracious Heavenly Father, We're grateful that we were able to know Sheri and be here to honor her. And Father, we're thankful for all the friends and family that were here and able to make it safely. We're grateful for the spirit that was felt and the love that we were able to feel as well. And Father, we're grateful for Jesus Christ and his atonement. And we're grateful for our Heavenly Father's plan. And we ask that you to bless us with safety. And we say these things in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.